Why is the universe Pythagorean? Is the question, is the title of my talk, formulated as a question. And I think that my main motivation is first to formulate what do I mean to call universe Pythagorean. And then the question will reveal its meaning. And then I will suggest what is on the market of ideas for possible answers of this question. And each of you could decide which answer is better, which is worse, or maybe I forgot some of your favorite answers. This would be a good comment, by the way, which I would appreciate. I tried, did not forget any answer, even those who do not seem to me quite reasonable. But if the answer is popular and circulating in among scientists and philosophers and general public, I try to reflect. Okay, so I will start. I will start my talk from a thing which I suppose many, if not all of you know. This is so-called fine-tuned universe. What does it mean, fine-tuned universe? Several decades ago, it's even hard to tell exactly when, because it was a process, it was realized gradually that the foundations of life and chemistry of existing of complicated atoms of this the table of elements heavily depends on fundamental physical constant. So if you will tune a little bit one or another fundamental constant, strictly speaking, dimensionless constant, but it doesn't matter for our talk. If you slightly change it, then you will realize that some of the important for chemistry, for table of elements, feature will disappear. Table of elements essentially disappear. I will give you just one example about this. Ratio of proton and neutron masses. As many of you may remember, neutron is a little heavier than proton. It's 1.5 per mil approximately. So 0.15% is a tiny fraction. The question is, what if neutron would be slightly more heavier than it is? Say, not 1.5 per mil, but they say 3 or 4 per mil. What will happen? Well, what will happen, neutrons will decay, in this case, not only as free particles as they decay normally, but also being within the nuclei. So nuclei would be able to consist only of protons in this case, because neutrons would decay. And then what sort of nuclei would we have? Only one, proton itself, nothing else. So would neutron be, say, 3 per mil instead of 1.5 per mil heavier than proton? Still tiny number. We would have only hydrogen atoms in our universe, nothing else, not even helium atom would exist, nothing to tell about more heavy atoms. Well, what if the opposite is correct? What if protons would be slightly heavier than neutrons? Well, then protons would decay, and we would not have even a single atom in our universe, even hydrogen atom would not exist. So the very existence of atoms out heavier than simplest hydrogen atom depends on the tiny disunion of the neutron mass from the proton. Would it be a little bit more or a little bit less? Well, our universe would be much more trivial than it is. Life, at least as we know it, would not exist. So this is not the only one example of fine-tuned universe, but I will limit my, there are many of them, by the way, and this is a wonderful book written 30 years ago of Burov and Tipler. It is called The Anthropic Cosmological Principle, and you may find there in this book, I don't know, maybe 100 of examples of fine-tuned features. Each of them is very important for possibilities of life, not about life, because we really do not know what life is. But for possibility for life, like table of elements, like not the universe consisting of black bodies, black holes only, etc. So fine-tuned universe discussed a lot between physicists and philosophers. There are special conferences, etc., etc. on this. But I think very important point is missed in this discussion. The discussion is focused on the specific value of physical constants. But physical constants enter in what? In the structure of physical laws. Physical laws are structured. It's not just values of constants. This special equation, as many of you know from school, classical celestial mechanics, electrodynamics, quantum mechanics, etc., they're structured mathematical entities. It's not just constant. Give me a constant and I will tell you. Where would you use this constant? You use it in special equations. But then the question is actually why the equations are very special, equations themselves. And at the first part of my talk, I'm going to show that the equations themselves, the structure, the very structure of the laws of nature is very, very special. And the missing of this point, the point of special structure of physical law, and being focused only on the values of constant, it's like, imagine, I will give you an example, which will illustrate the sort of logical mistake or blind spot or overlooking the essence. Imagine contemporary Robinson Crusoe, who had a shipwreck somewhere in the ocean and then survived somehow in desert island. And then he survived, he managed to live there some maybe year or two, managed to live, and then he suddenly found in some maybe cave working radio receiver in this desert island, which before he saw only just nature and nothing else, and no people. Then working radio receiver. And the radio receiver worked, not only was working, but it was tuned on very interesting and important for his life radio station. For instance, radio station which tells him how to survive better in this desert island. What would be the proper question of Robinson in this case? To ask why the radio receiver is tuned in exactly this wave on exactly this radio station, or why is radio receiver here at all? And together with the question, why is it tuned specially in this radio station? Of course, the second question would be proper. And if he would focus only on the question why it radio receiver is tuned on the proper radio station, it would be too narrow question. And he will most likely will use the point and maybe will make a wrong conclusion about the meaning of this radio receiver with its special tuning. So this is an illustration of sort of blind spot which I'm trying to explain. So now I'm going to my point of character of fundamental laws of physics. The fundamental laws of physics have several very important features. So let me start from the feature which is not so popular and reflected more rare than other features. This what physicists, theoretical physicists call mathematical beauty. What do they mean in mathematical beauty of physical law? And mathematically sensitive physicists, they feel this beauty. Actually, this is the motivation, mathematical beauty of physical law is, I think, motivation for many of us to work in physics. At least for me, when I realized when I was young, the physical laws, not just some formulas, maybe long enough where you may pack whatever you want, but really mathematically beautiful. It's actually mesmerized me. I was amazed by this, like a miracle. And if you'll read great physicists, you will see reflections on that. Not only Galileo, for instance, who said that the book of nature is written on the language of mathematics. Galileo definitely did not mean that the formulas could be extremely long and ugly. Being an artist, he meant that mathematics, as all sorts of art, at the core of it is beautiful. But also you may remember Paul Dirac, whose favorite motto was the laws of nature described in beautiful mathematics. You may remember Einstein, many quotations of Einstein when he meant this. You may remember the wonderful essay of Eugen Wigner, where this issue is also reflected. So what does it mean, really, this mathematical beauty? I think this term includes several important features. First, it is formal simplicity. Behind my back, there is my whiteboard where I wrote some laws of nature, fundamental laws of nature, starting from Newtonian mechanics, electrodynamics, even general relativity, principle of least action, and some. I'm not going to focus on them, just an example. So they are described in elegant, very short mathematical expressions, and those are fundamental laws of nature, not solution of some particular problems, which may contain really very long, maybe not so beautiful formulas, but the axioms of nature, the fundamental laws, they all are mathematically elegant. So they simple, formally simple, compact. At the same time, they are rich of interesting solutions. Their solutions are not set of banalities. Their solutions allow some interesting configurations in this world up to life. Richness of solutions. Many kinds of symmetry allowed actually the formulas of fundamental laws to be so compact. Many kinds of symmetries are behind all of them. And one more important point of mathematical beauty, they are not just simple, but simple as if suggesting itself as a hypothesis to a mind gifted with intuition. So let me give just one example. When Isaac Newton suggested that the force of gravity is 1/r². He was not the first who suggested this. 40 years ago, some French natural philosopher and Jesuit father, Bouillot, his name Bouillot, or in Latin, Bouillardis, he suggested the same, 1/r². And Hooke also suggested the same. Why all the, and Newton tested this hypothesis first, just to see is it compatible or not with Kepler's law. And he found, yes, Kepler's law exactly the consequence. Why all of they pointed out first to 1/r². It is a natural hypothesis, because as we would express it, this is flux preservation formula. It is the same formula which describes how good is, how well you may, how convenient it is to read your letter when you have a candle. So, with light, it is the same. Hello. Okay. With light, it is the same. So they are suggesting themselves this for sort of or look like they are suggesting themselves as a reasonable hypothesis, and it worked in many cases. So this all together is a mathematical beauty combined, is understood by physicists and felt by physicists as a special mathematical beauty of physical laws. Second feature of physical laws, of their special character, is their universality. So the laws are the same here on Earth and say very far from us on the other side of the universe, where still our telescopes are able to see, say, radiation, atomic spectra. Atomic spectra on the other side of the universe are exactly the same as in our part of the universe. And this, by the way, already was a part of special wonder of James Clerk Maxwell, who already knew that, of course, at Maxwell's time, it wasn't possible to see what I call other side of the universe, but still it was possible to see far enough from Earth. And it was clear that the molecular spectra, atomic spectra are the same. So the laws are the same with extremely good accuracy everywhere in the universe, they're universal. And they're universal with fantastic precision. When we check them, check the fundamental laws in experiments, we we find in sometimes extremely good agreement, like magnetic moment of electron. Magnetic moment of electron, how it is derived from the beautiful theory of quantum electrodynamics and how it is observed and measured in the experiment, they agree up to accuracy of the experiment, and accuracy of experiment is 12 digits. 12 digits of agreement between what is derived from our favorite mathematically elegant quantum electrodynamics and what completely different people are trying to measure, doing their best to measure in the experiment. They agree. They agree with extraordinary accuracy, 12 digits. So this I call universality of the physical law. The third feature of physical laws, which I'd like to stress, I call conjugation of layers. When scientific revolution in 20th century happened, discovery of quantum mechanics, discovery of special and general relativity, some people, mostly not physicists, but philosophers, used the word that old classical physics is wrong. It is refuted and it is wrong. But I do not know any great name among physicists who used the word wrong to Newtonian mechanics. They use completely different words. Newtonian, for instance, the book which I use as my textbook in the university and still using time to time, Landau-Lifshitz, Theoretical Physics, Volume 3 about quantum mechanics, how Landau and Lifshitz wrote about classical physics. The classical physics plays double role with respect to quantum physics. First, it is its limit case, exact mathematical limit case, when H tends to zero, when Planck constant tends to zero. And another point is that it connects quantum prediction of quantum theory with what classical devices are measuring. So for me, it is more important the first point of Landau, and it wasn't just specific point of Landau. It's essentially all physicists understood it like that, that classical physics is not wrong. It is a limit case. It shows itself as a limit case in exact mathematical sense of new theories. And new theories discovers reveal some new understanding of the world, new features, new understanding of space-time, for instance, new understanding of what atoms are and what and of many things, revealing a new picture. But old picture is not thrown out as wrong. The old picture shows a new role as exact asymptotically correct limit cases of new theory. So this I call conjugation of layers of old and new theories. And this conjugation is very important because whenever physicists are looking for a new theory, they care a lot about this conjugation, this old, well-established theory. It could not be just a patchwork, one patch, another patch, and put them for different colors, different materials. No. All theories must be limit cases of new ones. This is very important, conjugation of layers. And finally, the laws happen to be friendly to life appearing and developing up to intellect. Following the established terminology, I call it anthropness of the laws of nature. Although maybe this term is not the best one because we don't know, maybe some other not quite similar to us thinking beings exist in our universe. It's possible. So it's more than about us. With respect to the naming of this feature of the laws of nature, anthropness means that the laws of nature are compatible with the appearance and developing of thinking beings in the universe. That's what means anthropness. So you see there are four very important features of the laws of nature. And some of them, anthropness especially, connected, associated with the fine-tuned universe, with ideas of fine-tuning of the constant. But other three, no, they're all about structure, not about specific values of the laws of nature. So laws of nature are very special. They combine in itself many opposite complementary features. For instance, mathematical beauty and elegance. Mathematical elegance assumes rather simple features of the law. But anthropness requires richness of solution to allow for life to appear, rather complicated structures to appear and be stable in the universe. So the laws are both simple enough to be mathematically elegant and complicated enough to allow very powerful and rich solutions of them. And all these features of the laws combined together, for all these features combined together, I call it that the laws has a feature of discoverability. They are discoverable by the thinking beings which appear in the same universe subdued to the same laws. And these thinking beings are able to discover their own laws, which due to what their existence was possible. So this is a loop here. So discoverability, this is combined integral term for the laws of nature. It assumes a certain loop that the laws are compatible with their own discoverability, but not from outsiders, but from insiders. So this is all about features of our laws and our universe, which is governed to a certain degree, maybe not completely, but to a certain degree, very significant degree by the laws. We call it Pythagorean universe, on the name of great ancient thinker, Pythagoras, who first proclaimed mathematical importance for understanding the material world, and who is author to a very strange but very powerful statement, all things are numbers. Of course, you have to understand it with a grain of salt, as I do, but it is very important, important prophecy, I would say. Very important prophecy, which sits at the core of contemporary science. So then the question is, why the laws are discoverable, or why the universe where we find ourselves and the only universe we know, maybe there are no other, maybe there are other, we don't know, why the universe is Pythagorean. Now I am coming to possible answers, to existing answers on the market to this question. First, the order which I will use to list these answers is more or less arbitrary. So just do not pay much attention why I put them in this order, not in another. You may put it in different order. So let me start from scientific and scientism, this philosophical sort of teaching. Scientific answer. Science is the only reliable way of cognition, and the fundamental laws constitute its terminus in an epistemological sense. Its terminus. So there is no reason to ask. The question is unanswerable. This is scientific answer. And what could be objection to a scientific answer? Well, the statement itself that science is the only reliable way of cognition is not scientific. The statement. So it is either unreliable or just wrong on its own ground. It is an example of self-refutation in the form of what is known in logic as Epimenides' paradox. Let me remind you this old ancient story when a poet of sixth century, actually, before Christ, Epimenides from Creta, says that all Cretans are liars, and he was Cretan himself. So it was a this statement cannot be right because it is self-refutation. And this is a form of a paradox which appears and appears again in many philosophical teachings. In many philosophical teachings, you may find this paradox of Epimenides. And this self-refutation, so you cannot then take even as a hypothetically correct this teaching, which includes in itself Epimenides' paradox. And scientific statement that science is the only reliable way of cognition included in itself is a form of Epimenides' paradox. Another existing example is skeptical. All knowledge is unreliable, says this is the most full and total skepticism. All knowledge is unreliable, so we do not know why the laws are such, and we are not able actually to reach any reliable statement about this issue. Well, this is one more example of Epimenides' paradox itself, because if all knowledge is unreliable, this very statement is unreliable as well. So this is self-refutation. And again, we are going further. So one more possible answer, possible or not, I don't know, but existing and repeating time to time, is Darwinian, I call it. So the laws are discoverable because the evolution made humans clever enough. Humans become clever enough, and then sooner or later, when they are progressing, humans, we are progressing, and in one good day, we are starting to discover the laws. Well, this objection misses the point, because to be discoverable, the laws should be very special by themselves, as I explained before, simple enough, elegant, symmetrical, et cetera, et cetera. So, the Darwinian statement, the Darwinian attempt to explain the discoverability misses the point of the very special feature of the law. Would laws expressed by such long formulas, some ugly, long, et cetera, or incomprehensible for human mind, then they would be never discovered. Especially first laws are very, very simple. And then the next level of laws, when they discover it again and again, the next level of laws are complicated and interesting enough to make it hard to discover them, but still simple enough to be for us to be able to discover them. So there is a sort of gradually increasing challenge for humanity, for the laws to be discoverable. The first law, the Newtonian celestial mechanics, is extremely simple. An intuition which follows from common objects like candlelight leading to the right answer. So all this is missed in the Darwinian answer. So one more popular answer is what I call postmodern or postmodernistic answer. The laws are what people want them to look like. They are elegant because physicists like it. Humans like elegance, humans like beauty, humans like something to deal with, simplicity of ideas, and the laws are so, you wanted it and you got it. What is the surprise? Well, this sort of thinking may work in humanities, but not in physics. Physical hypotheses are severely checked and selected in experiments. It's impossible to follow a wrong idea and not to be punished by nature sooner or later. Also, the competition between scientific groups is very hard. And refutations of distinguished theories are highly rewarded. So all these features make it just impossible for physicists to establish and to accept theories which are not in very significant agreement with the observations and experimental data. So we are really doing very hard work. We are in physics of all time, just to check and measure, to try to refute. We are trying to refute, we are doing our best, trying to refute our favorite theories. That's what we are doing. So situation is, and nature helps us in this respect. So we, it is possible in physics, not maybe in humanities as much, but in physics, yes. It is possible to make experiments which will tell you yes or no, which will refute your favorite theory. All the world of physics may be happy about some theory, but if experiment refutes it, the theory would be set under big questioning, maybe will be modernized, maybe thrown away at all. So postmodern answer to the question why is the universe Pythagorean just does not work for physics. Only people who do not know, really do not know how physics work, may proclaim it. Maybe some humanitarian really have very, very wrong idea about physicists and physics, how physics works. So that's why they maybe suggest that sort of answer. But this is definitely a wrong answer, as I think every student of physics at the very beginning already knows. One more possible answer is chaos genetics. The laws happen to be discovered accidentally. Discoverable. The laws happen to be discoverable accidentally. This is the statement. Within an infinite multiverse, let's assume a multiverse, with all possible laws, everything is possible. So if you will assume that there is a multiverse with all possible laws, then everything is possible, then in one or another universe, the laws will be discovered. Discoverable will be discovered, and what is surprise? No surprise, just happened to be so. Well, this is what I called chaos genetic explanation. This is term of myself and Lev, we called it like this. And objection to this explanation, that if we would accept that sort of explanation as a paradigm of possible and acceptable explanation, then whatever may be explained in this way, whatever will happen, this explanation would work well. In the infinite multiverse, everything is possible, and this specific event, however strange it is, well, in the infinite multiverse, it is possible. Well, it happens. So it's actually explaining everything. It explains nothing. So this is actually not an explanation. It is a fake. It's something looking like explanation, but actually not. So it is a fake of explanation. That's what it is. Chaos of genesis. This is multiverse. This everything suggesting that everything happens. So one more. It is maybe it is variant of chaos of genetic explanation. It's weak anthropic explanation. The laws are anthropic, because in an infinite multiverse, only anthropic universes can be inhabited and asked about their law. Although this truism cannot be wrong, but it cannot explain the discoverability of laws either, because it does not answer for the question of discoverability. At best, it may answer to the question of to the feature, why the laws are anthropic, but not about discoverable. They has nothing to do with, say, this mathematical beauty, simplicity, universality, et cetera, all these features which I mentioned. Only the force feature at best. I really do not think that even force feature can be explained by this way, but let's set it aside. Only one feature is pretended to be explained. All others are forgotten. So it's not explanation at all. And then the last possible explanation which I'd like to discuss is creationist explanation. And creationist explanation, which combines with itself actually many possible conflicting explanations in general, it could be formulated like this. The Pythagorean universe is created, it is Pythagorean, mathematical elegance, etc., anthropic, discoverable laws, etc., is created by powerful deity, demiurge, for instance, let me use the term demiurge of Plato, for whatever purpose. We don't know what is purpose, so we may discuss about purpose, but powerful and very mindful, very powerful as the mind and creative power, deity created the universe. Variants differ ethically. There are many variants of creationist hypothesis. It has its own branch of variants. And for instance, demiurge may exploit humans why Demiurge created the world? To exploit humans. This is one variant, a sort of evil demon which created humans as his slaves, or maybe to entertain him. And this idea, by the way, is very popular in the media, like Matrix, for instance, movie, or Evil Demon of Descartes. This is about this. In general, I call it Gnostic variant of creationism. Then this deity could be uncaring. He just created the universe, maybe enjoying how it all fits together, and then maybe started to build up the universe, forgot about this universe, so uncaring about people. This is deistic world. God as a watchmaker, God created, watches the world, like watches, then put watches go by themselves, maybe with some play of random number generators, maybe not, and then God doing his own stuff. He doesn't care about people and maybe about the universe at all. Maybe he already forgot about it. So this is deistic variant of creationism. And there is a third variant, it is theistic variant. God loves universe as an artist loves his creature, and God loves people. So this is theistic branch of creationist hypothesis. So we have to distinguish all of these, because many problems when people are started to think about the universe, many problems appear because they do not distinguish important things. So creationists, there are many creationist hypotheses. We have to distinguish them. So let's assume for a moment creationism in general with all its branches, and then what is objection to creationism with all these branches from Gnostic, deistic, or theistic variant? Objection, this just shifts the problem a level up. Why then is the Demiurge there, the creator of the world? Who created the creator? This is the objection. This is an objective question. What could be an answer to this question? Creationism, even very general, establishes the primacy of mind, leading to the question about terminus of being. So even with all these uncertainties within creationism, primacy of mind is already established by the creation. And this is important statement which has its content. It's not something empty. It is important philosophical statement. All deep philosophical traditions express the same answer about the terminus in various words, about the terminus, who created the creator, where the creator himself came. In terms of Platonic tradition, which is one who thought behind the creator, behind the Demiurge, where the Demiurge himself came from. In the Platonic tradition, it is one good, or just the good of Plato, or one good of Plotinus and Platonism, or goodness per se, or the unity of goodness. So the unity of goodness is stated as the ultimate terminus, ultimate reason for everything, for universe to exist, including Demiurge himself. So then objection is, if one good is the terminus, of goodness per se, whence is evil then? This actually would lead me, I would just say a few words about this, because problem of evil is a special problem which deserves by itself, many books are written on that and deserves itself a lot of talk. I think the best answer to the problem of evil was given by a great physicist, Freeman Dyson, recently passed away at the age of 96. I will quote him, his answer. I actually love his answer and I share it. His words would finish my talk better than anybody else. And I am finishing my talk, so with a quotation of Freeman Dyson from his book, Infinite in All Directions. And the book was published in 1988. And then he repeated essentially the same in his Templeton Prize talk in in the year 2000. He received the Templeton Prize for his philosophical and scientific ideas and together mixing them together. So, quotation from Freeman Dyson. I do not claim any ability to read God's mind. I am sure of only one thing. When we look at the glory of stars and galaxies in the sky, and the glory of forests and flowers in the living world around us, it is evident that God loves diversity. Perhaps the universe is constructed according to the principle of maximum diversity. The principle of maximum diversity, this is Dyson formulation, says that the laws of nature and the initial conditions at the beginning of time are such as to make the universe as interesting as possible. As a result, life is possible, but not too easy. Maximum diversity often leads to maximum stress. In the end, we survive, but only by the skin of our teeth. This is the confession of faith of scientific heretic, as he called himself. And in the same book, in some other place, he repeats this idea in some different words. As a working hypothesis to explain the riddle of our existence, I propose that our universe is the most interesting of all possible universes, and our fate as human beings is to make it so. So we live in the most interesting of all possible universes. This is a statement of Freeman Dyson, and you may find this same structure is the statement that famous Leibniz statement that we live in the best of all possible worlds. Dyson formulates it more precisely, I would say, more specifically, and maybe more interesting than Leibniz. We live in the most interesting of all possible worlds, and this assumes, if you will think about this, maybe one of the most tragic of all possible worlds. So, what somebody could object on this? I don't know, but maybe a possible objection would be, well, it doesn't clearly say why the laws are discoverable. I think it does, because Pythagoreanness makes the universe much more interesting and diverse. And Dyson clearly stressed this. One more quotation, the last quotation from Dyson. Laws of nature are explained if it can be established that they must be as they are in order to allow the existence of theoretical physicists to speculate about them. It's kind of a slightly humoristic way, but the idea is there. Again, the same book, Infinite Knowledge Direction of Freeman Dyson. So how could I conclude all this? Like, what was definitely a universe with discoverable laws and discovering physicists is much more interesting than without. And I hope people who are listening to me would agree with that. At least I hope that physicists would agree, but maybe not only physicists. And I am sure that fathers of science would enthusiastically applaud to that if they were with us. Maybe they are. So that's, I think, I just finished in time, more or less. So that's the end of my talk. Thank you so much. Now, questions.
I'm not a physicist, I'm not a scientist, but I am an actor. And there's an old idea that God is a great dramatist, and how boring life would be. Or drama, what makes drama is the conflict, you know, conflict of good and evil. And the great Elizabethan playwright Christopher Marlowe used the phrase gorgeous tragedy. Of course, he was describing a form of drama, but of course, tragedy as a dramatic form reflects our lives. So you can't have gorgeous tragedy just on the stage, but life itself can be a gorgeous tragedy, which is kind of a paradoxical statement, but I think it is true. So that's just my little contribution to this.
Thank you, Peter. I think I could only agree with you. And I think it is very much in line with Freeman Dyson vision of life. I think you suggested a commentary from your perspective of the same idea. Thank you.
There is a question in the chat from Steve Schwartz. Is there a path to an explanation?
I am not sure that I really understand this question. Is there a path to an explanation? Could you please, Stephen, a little bit open more your question?
Yes, here I am. So you offered all kinds of explanations and then objections to the explanations. And the hope of scientists, I guess, would be that we'll understand why the universe is Pythagorean someday. Do you see that possibility, or is it always going to be an open question? Is there a path to a best explanation?
I don't think that it is possible to answer this question within strict frame of science, because science, what science is doing, science is discovering the laws first, and then science is, within science, people are thinking how to apply them for many different technical things. So we are discovering them and we are using them in science. But the question why the laws are what they are, with all these interesting features, by definition leads us out science, the scientific realm. So all the explanations, possible explanations, which I suggested you to your judgment, they are all outside of scientific realm. So and they will be forever. At least if will people preserve that meaning of the concept of science which we have now. Maybe in the future people will have completely different idea about science itself, and then they will decide again this question. But as soon as we understand science, as I just said, we are discovering the laws and then we are using them, it's impossible to answer the question why the laws are what they are. You may suggest some super law, say the law, say, of energy preservation, or the laws of electrodynamics, quantum or classical, or standard model, whatever you like. They are consequence of some more general statement. Okay, but then the question will be, why this general statement, say theory of everything or final theory, why is it correct? Again, you have to go outside to try to suggest, to see some possible answers. So scientifically it's impossible, I don't know.
Is there a connection to Gödel in this regard?
Maybe, but this actually very deep and complicated statement, I do not see that it is directly connected, but some connection could be there, because Gödel's statement is very, very general. Gödel's theorems are very general, and it's really hard even to find any branch of philosophy, especially philosophy of science, which is not related in one or another way with Gödel's theorem.
Thanks very much.
Yes, I really enjoyed your talk. I got in a little late because I misread the time for it, but I did want to say something to Stephen's question. I do think you can make progress on this whole question, and that's, as you know, is my current project, which is about nearing completion. And the idea is this: if the universe is somehow teleologically ordered for discoverability, as you're suggesting in your last explanation, then you would expect this not only to show up in the structure of the laws, but also in the positioning of the values of the fundamental parameters. So you can then look at what happens when you vary those fundamental parameters and see what happens to, for example, the physical processes involved in our ability to discover the universe and the tools that we use. And that's been, I've done that all the way from the non-particle physics parameters that are adjustable all the way down now through the particle physics ones. And it does seem to turn out that they're in a small region that seems to maximize discoverability. So if that becomes a test of this general idea, And if I'm right about that, it seems to pass the test. So you're making some progress in that you've actually been able to test this idea that might seem somewhat subjective, because we're impressed. Like you say, there's a lot of reasons to be impressed with how the laws are formulated, that we can discover them at all.
Yeah, thank you so much for your comment. And I fully agree and appreciate your own efforts in the direction. I think they are very interesting. And this is one more interesting bridge between philosophy and physics, cosmology and philosophy, which can show us a little more than conventional fine-tuned universe concept, which takes into account tuning constants to make life possible. But you are saying that constants are tuned specially also to make the laws discoverable, as you're showing in some of your articles, which I appreciate so much. So thank you so much for this comment. I highly agree with this.
But I really enjoyed your talk. I thought you were very thorough, which would be a lot of things to focus on. There's so many things you covered.
Thank you. Thank you.
Alexey.
I appreciate you coming.
Lyosha, please check the chat. There are a couple of questions in the chat.
A couple of questions from Matt C. Thanks for the great talk. I wonder if you could speak to the entropy problem of the universe, i.e. That the universe began with relatively low entropy. This is important for life, since low entropy energy is needed for life. It seems to me that if many universes exist, this would provide a simple explanation that is also consistent with, at least with, the spirit of physics. You mentioned the multiverse hypothesis, but I wonder if you could speak to this in light of the entropy problem. Well, if you will take one or another specific union, for instance, low entropy for initial conditions, you may try to build one or another, and some people suggest one or another multiverse hypothesis. But the point is that you have to take into account altogether, not only entropy law, but the laws of very special, of very special character. This is, you know, let me give you an example. We all read wonderful in our childhood and teenager stories about Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson. What was the difference between Holmes and Watson approaches to crime explanation and to discovery who committed the crime? The difference was that Holmes tried to take into account all the important features, and he was very observable, and he took into account many of them. Why Dr. Watson? He actually was focused on one or another feature and easily built the wrong explanation, which was suggested by one or another, only few features, or which they saw on the field of crime. So we should follow rather Mr. Holmes than Dr. Watson, I would say, in this respect. Or Inspector Lestrade in this same the same example of the Watson approach. So we should follow Holmes, not Inspector Lestrade or Dr. Watson. So when you focus only on the entropy, you may build some model if you forget about everything. Some model, but then you should check everything. That's what I try to do in my
Can I just make a comment on this one? Because actually the entropy case is a good example of discoverability. As many have pointed out, like Sean Carroll, for instance, if you just had a random universe and it was just life was all that it was, like in a multiverse explanation, then you would expect us to be in a very small region of low entropy. You don't need a whole universe with low entropy for life, but you do need a whole entropy for low entropy with low entropy for discoverability. Otherwise you wouldn't have other galaxies, you wouldn't see other stars. You wouldn't be able to discover the universe began in a Big Bang. You wouldn't be able to do astrophysics or cosmology at all. So really the low entropy of the universe throughout is a case of fine tuning for discoverability, but not fine tuning for life, because you don't need it for have a life permitting universe.
Yes, I agree. That's very correct statement.
Lesha, there is another question in the in the chat.
Yuri Dashko. First of all, thanks for the interesting talk. A question about simplicity. Naively, it seems like Newton's law for gravitation attraction is simpler than general relativistic equations, which are quite complicated. Coulomb's law is much simpler than more adequate formulation of Maxwell equations, which are simpler than electroweak theory, and so on. It appears that the more adequate laws are more complicated. Can you comment on this? Yes, it's a very good point. And I tried actually to comment on this, to take it into account when I suggested the concept which I called conjugation of layers. So the next layer of law, say general relativity in comparison to Newton's celestial mechanics, is conjugated with Newton's celestial mechanics. It suggested you a challenge, and then it makes possible a drama of discoverability. Because imagine that Newton's law would be the whole story. Then this drama of discoverability would take a relatively short period of history, and then humans would do something else. The physics become boring. But physics is not boring yet. maybe it will not be boring long time ahead, because the new challenges appear, and new challenges are more complicated and more interesting and harder to discover than the previous one. So when I'm talking about simplicity, I do not mean that the laws are as simple as logically possible. No. I mean that they are simple enough to be in principle discoverable, because we may imagine that the laws are so complicated that they would not be discovered at all, never. For instance, if instead of very simple Newton laws of celestial mechanics would be something as complicated as general relativity from the start, without this limit case, well, I would suppose that it will be never discoverable, because people were encouraged a lot. We have to remember that historically, physics developed by the power of enthusiasm after the laws of simpler level were discovered. So Newton's celestial mechanics makes huge enthusiasm among intellectuals of Europe. And many gifted young people pointed their efforts to try to discover new laws because they were encouraged by Newton's example. Imagine that this did not happen. Nobody would be encouraged. Well, people lived for centuries, for millennia, without any idea that the laws could be discovered, because who we are and who is the author of everything? The very idea that we may read his mind about the general structure of whole universe, this idea is very bold, actually. This idea is not easy to accept, and it was not accepted, actually. It was not accepted. So it just was a special gift for humanity to be able to start to discover. So that's about simplicity. The laws are simple enough to be discoverable and complicated enough to make the whole drama of discoverability interesting and even dramatic and sometimes even tragic.
You mind if I jump in there, or do you want me to not say anything?
Yes, you may jump.
Okay, so please, Robin. As you know, I've also addressed this, and I've called it hierarchical simplicity. Mm-hmm. So the idea is like Newton worked within a certain conceptual framework, right? A Euclidean space-time. And within that framework, if you wrote Einstein's equation in that framework, you would get Newton's laws plus an infinite number of correction terms. It happens where we exist. We don't exist around a black hole. Those correction terms, you don't see them except when you do very, very fine measurements. And so what it allowed for is all this development of Newtonian mechanics. But then on the next conceptual level, which Newton would have never got to alone, you look at the margins, you see it's not quite adequate. That allows you to go to the next conceptual level and then look for simplicity in that level, the level of non-Riemannian geometry. And you write the simplest equation in that level, and then you get Einstein's equation. The same thing happens from quantum, classical mechanics to quantum, and the person that mentioned Coulomb's law to Maxwell's equations. So I think, you know, you have this step-like structure that gets you into deeper and deeper conceptual levels that you would have never been able to get to those simpler laws at those much more abstract conceptual levels without the initial steps in the ladder.
So it's sort of when you're learning in school, first you have learned simple arithmetic, how to add numbers. Then you are learning something more, then you are solving some algebraical equations, then you are going to integrals and maybe derivatives and partial derivative equations, more complicated group theory and whatever, but you have to start from arithmetic. So that looks very pretty much what happens with physics in this history of physics. Arithmetic was possible. And this is one of the miracles of the laws. They suggested very low starting level. Starting level was available. And this was Newton's celestial mechanics.
And you also
Galileo laws and Kepler orbits is also one of the miracles because the orbits were very so simple mathematically that it was possible for Kepler to discover that they are ellipses without knowing any idea why. But he just checked except of this circle, it was one more mathematical example of the closed curve to check other orbits, if not circles, but then what? Maybe ellipses. And the answer is yes, ellipses. But why ellipses? Why not something so complicated that even Kepler would be puzzled? Well, I don't know what it is, and nobody will discover. And this is also an interesting feature of the structure of the law of gravity, because of the ellipses are a consequence of 1/r² and the force. So that's why ellipses are there. If the power of the force wouldn't be 2, but say 2.5 or 1.75 or whatever else, the orbits wouldn't be closed even. Life maybe will still exist, maybe if you will add some correction to the. But Kepler looking at the orbits wouldn't realize that there are ellipses. And Newton would not have great help of Kepler. And Newton's celestial mechanics wouldn't be possible as well. And so physics wouldn't be possible. That's it. Okay, so the next question of, one more question of Yuri Dashkov. If we imagine that we found an answer, let's call it A to the question, why is the universe such and such? Will we be able and accept it as a final question or will be asking why as A then and so on and on recursively? It is possible to arrive, is it possible to arrive at the final answer at all in your opinion? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's also I tried to touch this question when I said about terminus of explanation. What could be a terminus? Because, well, if you explain something by A, as Yuri suggests, then the question would be, why A then? And this is a very old philosophical problem, fully realized by Plato, for instance, that answering to this question, what may be reasonably accepted as a terminus of explanation, he suggested the good one, as Plotinus called it, but they meant the same. Spinoza called this the substance. So essentially, they meant the same thing, but they used different words. So what could be the terminus? Instead of terminus, you may have some totality which includes in itself everything which may appear reasonably. That's what is terminus. So something which does not have any whatever special, because if something which you are trying to use as a terminus of explanation uses some special features, you will immediately ask the question, why your terminus has this special features, not something else? And this is the very possibility of this question would mean that something special, whatever it is, cannot be terminus of explanation. Terminus of explanation could be some totality, some fullness, some completeness. And what sort of completeness it could be? Plato suggested that this good itself could be this completeness? This is a big question. I'm not going to go into details, and because it would require a lot of philosophy to discuss this. But I think this is essentially right. And among contemporary philosophers of science in particular, John Leslie is a proponent of Platonic point of view, and I think he is right. Robin will correct me if I am wrong.
Yeah, you're right about that, generally speaking, yeah. He's an advocate of what's called the axiarchic principle, that what yes. ought to be is. And so basically, if you given that, you kind of get the functional equivalent of God and as an explanation.
Yeah. And I think all great religious traditions, they share this vision of the unity of good. As an ultimate term, they use their special language and many special features to describe divinity. But at that very abstract philosophical level, I think great philosophical traditions they all agree in this.
But usually, philosophers that address this usually say, like God or whatever is ultimate, necessarily exists of a sort of logical necessity, and so then it becomes self-explanatory. Mm-hmm. That's often how it goes for trying to get a terminus of explanation.
Yeah.
Okay, do we have more questions?
Yes, if I could just add one comment. I'm not a scientist, but it struck me, Dyson's comment struck me as very much akin to I would just say at least the Orthodox Christian perspective on the Holy Spirit, that is infinitely creative. And in the saints, in fact, we believe they come in every variety and will continue to come in every possible manifestation of human persona. So anyway, it's a similarity. I'll just leave it at that.
Thank you. So we have one more question from Alexander Garifal, if I pronounce the name correctly. This is indeed very much touched upon in the uncaused cause. I speak more from the Thomistic tradition, a terminus to in a opposition to the infinite regress alluded to here. Yes. So we need terminus if we believe that a reasonable approach is not based on something absurdic ultimately. We need terminus. And what can be the terminus and what cannot be terminus? And this is all problem which goes back to ancient time, to Plato, to Heraclitus, and then to Christian tradition, of course, and to Indian philosophy. So it's very big philosophical question. And I think big traditions would agree that the only reasonable possible answer to this question is the unity of good. I think that Plato expressed not only his own specific solution to the question of terminus, but essentially all big traditions agree. They disagree in some more specific aspects of divinity relation to humans, but here they, I think, all agree. Some more questions?
Well, I have a question coming again from a non-scientist. In the nature of proof, you know, coming up with a proof of an idea, I can only relate this through my husband's work as he's a mathematical economist. And so in that economic modeling of mathematics, all proofs have assumptions. I mean, they need assumptions in order to work. Is that, which I consider actually a kind of faith, is that the same with these questions of physics that you're posing, that they require assumptions in order for proofs to work?
Yes, of course, physics is based on a whole pattern of assumptions, I would say. The nearest and most obvious assumptions of physics, if you work in physics, assumptions of already discovered laws of nature, paradigm of approach to them. This is one sort of assumption, but these assumptions are sort of nearest assumption, the most superficial assumption. There are deeper assumptions, assumptions which relate to the value of fundamental physics, to the value of discovery. Why we value this? What is important? What is the importance of this? Why we believe that we are able to discover new laws, for instance, and invest some money in new devices like new big accelerators, new telescopes, etc. Why we care about this? Do we care because we hope that some benefits for our comfort of our life will come, or maybe something else? Maybe this is spiritual, spiritual power behind all this. Not really much related to helping us to live better. With all respect, of course, to this desire to live better. So all these assumptions which structure our values of fundamental science, and our beliefs in our ability to discover something new and precious, they constitute deeper level of science, very important, but people normally do not discuss it, rarely discuss it, because deep things are rarely discussed.
Thank you.
Thank you for your question. I see one more question from Matt to everyone. Thanks for answering my question. I wonder if one could make an argument that the laws of the universe may not be as discoverable as we might think. For example, about 95% of the energy density of the universe has a mysterious origin. In some ways, quantum field theory seems to have great predictive power, but it implies a cosmological constant that is perhaps 10 to the 120 too large. For example, general relativity provides a mathematical solution known as the white hole, but no white hole seems to exist. Can you speak to this? Yes, it's a very good question. So what I meant about discoverability, that it is possible, it was possible for humanity so far to discover a lot. What I did not mean by this is that we are able to discover everything. And I did not even think possible and reasonable claim as we already discovered it. No, we are not discovered everything. We are still far from that. But what we already discovered is actually a big thing. So I your question gave me an excuse for using one more of my favorite numbers. The laws of nature, which somehow discover, not completely, but to important degree, cover a huge range of parameters. So the smallest object, which was discovered by theoretical physics and then theoretical and experimental physics together, is Higgs boson. Higgs boson was predicted 50 years ago by English mathematical physicist, theoretical physicist, Peter Higgs. He predicted it on the ground of mathematical beauty and all these features of laws which I formulated, but essentially from his head, and which was not actually something very new, because for instance, Einstein in fundamental physics, Einstein also wrote general relativity from his head without a single experiment which he could use as a help in this. Also, Maxwell corrected the equations of electrodynamics from his head, from the mathematical beauty, pure reason, and things like that. So Peter Higgs did the same. And then it took 50 years for physicists, experimental physicists, to discover it. And then this is important. And it happened at the scale, at what scale it happened? It happened at the scale 10 to the minus 18 meters. 10 to the minus 18 meters. So it is one divided on one with 18 zeros. It's a huge number. We do not even have a word for this number. How small this scale where Higgs boson reveals itself is compared to our own size. and we already discovered something important there. Top quark was discovered at the same scale. So this is the smallest object which became seen by humanity, both theoretically and experimentally, 10 to the minus 18 meters. And now actually LHC is working one order of magnitude deeper, 10 to the minus 19 meters. Did not see anything interesting yet, as far as I know, at this scale. Would we see anything interesting, or maybe nothing, who knows? But 10 to the minus 19 meters, one order of magnitude more than Higgs boson, is contemporary level of being, of material world, where we are looking for something new. 10 to the minus 19 meters, remember this number. But what is the biggest scale? The biggest scale is the easiest way from Big Bang. We remember 14 billion years ago, the universe started approximately, according to our main theories and observations also. 14 billion years, if you multiply it to the speed of light, you will have number 10 to the 26 meters. In meters again. So 10 to the 26 meters is the biggest object which we see, which we theorize, where we check our hypothesis. I'm not saying that we know everything, no, but we know something very important there, and something important was discovered was there. So if you will divide the size of the biggest object which physics discovered, the universe or visible universe itself, 10 to the 26 meters, on the smallest object, Higgs boson and top quark, and where LHC is now, 10 to the minus 19 meters, you will have dimensionless number without units, 10 to the 45. 10 to the 45 is dimensionless number, which shows the range of discoverability of contemporary physics. So this number, because it is dimensionless, it's not in meters, in seconds, or whatever, it is just number. This number tells where we are now with respect to humanity, where humanity is now, with respect of cognition of the universe. This is very important parameter, 10 to the 45, dimensionless parameter. So imagine some fantastic club of reasonable beings from everywhere from the universe, and a representative of humanity has a minute in this big council of thinking beings from all over the universe to represent humanity, to say who we are, where we are. I think that the best answer, within a very short time, is to say that we are at the range of 10 to the 45 to understand the universe. And this is universal, it's expressed in numbers. So all other thinking beings would in principle be able to understand it, because if this representative of humanity will bring, say, Shakespeare poem, most likely they wouldn't understand what it is. It would require very complicated translation. Or music, who knows, maybe they would not be able to understand our music. But 10 to the 25, 10 to the 45, this is universal number. And this is a feature of reason per se. And most likely it will be possible to communicate, to tell who we are. So this is the answer of who we are. And what is the scale of human cognition of the universe? Yes, we don't understand everything, but we understand much, much more than even the most darest people who dare and boldest thinkers could imagine, say, 200 or even 100 years ago.
Russia, there is another question in the chat.
Yeah, I see. From
Tim Benzman.
Benzman, yes. One question about the low entropy of life. Would it be reasonable to say that the universe is still very young in the scheme of things, so that it is a very long way from reaching heat depth? For instance, it is generally estimated that there will still be stars producing energy through fusion for roughly another 15 trillion years, about 1,000 times longer than the current age of the universe. So the heat death definitely not a danger of not today or tomorrow. we are safe from this danger at least for a long time enough. About these orders of magnitude, I think, right, which you suggested. So we may consider a good resource given to humanity from this respect.
Yes.
Thanks for those who gave us this resource. Huh?
Yeah, we live at, well, because of this factor of 10 to the 45, you mentioned the equilibration time of the universe is very, very long. So, yes. Well, we're as you say, we're in no danger of heat death anytime soon.
Yes, how we would use, how humanity is going to use this big resource, is of course open question, who knows? Hopefully it will be used rather reasonably in the interesting way to follow this idea of Freeman Dyson and to make our universe even more interesting than we did before.